So today we're going to start with the chapter of enzymes. Enzymes are biological catalysts. So obviously the question arises that what are catalysts? Think of it this way, that you are having a reaction going on, any reaction at all, and you add a substance to it that is providing a site, an extra surface area for the reaction to occur more efficiently, for more frequent and efficient collisions, and that substance is lowering the amount of energy you need to start or activate that reaction. That is basically a catalyst. Catalysts are substances, are chemical substances that can speed up or alter chemical reactions without being chemically changed at the end of that reaction. They are not chemically altered at all. So when that reaction is over, you will find the catalyst in the exact same way you had added it. We're talking about the chemical composition, not the physical composition. So catalysts are needed in small quantities. They can be used over and over again. You can reuse them. They allow reactions to take place at lower temperatures. So what do? They lower the activation energy. So for the purple graph, without the catalyst, if you see, it requires a large amount of activation energy. But when you add a catalyst, this activation energy is lowered and less energy is required for the reaction to take place. So this is how your catalysts work. This is how they speed up a reaction. And inorganic catalysts are not destroyed by heating or a change of pH. So that means that organic catalysts are affected by the pH or the temperature of the substance they are in. So, well, what are organic catalysts? Or the term organic means that it contains hydrogen and carbon. So organic catalysts are termed enzymes because they contain carbon and hydrogen, and they're basically protein in nature. So enzymes are biological catalysts that are protein in nature, and they can alter or speed up a chemical reaction without itself being chemically changed at the end of the reaction. So from this, we can gather that out of all the catalysts, a section of organic catalysts is termed as enzymes. So enzymes come under the category of catalysts. And enzymes, how do they work? They control the cell's metabolism. What is metabolism? We're going to discuss it further on. But in simple terms, a cell's metabolism is the sum of chemical reactions that is taking place within the cell. So enzymes can either build up or break down different substances, and they can catalyze reversible reactions, which means that if an enzyme used two substrates, joined them together and formed a product, the enzyme can also break down the product to the original substrates. And this way, enzymes catalyze particularly all chemical reactions that occur in organisms. For example, in humans, digestion is catalyzed by enzymes such as amylase, lipase, protease, etc. And these enzymes are produced only when they are required. This is how enzymes look like, and you can see some different shapes within these enzymes, which are actually the active sites of enzymes into which the substrate can actually go and fit. So how do enzymes work? There is a lock and key hypothesis for how enzymes work. What does that mean? Enzymes work on substrates just like you can use a key and a lock. So always remember that the enzyme is going to be the lock and the substrate is going to be the key. So what happens? You have a substrate and it fits into the enzyme. How does it do so? Enzymes are specific for different substrates. Their active sites, the site where they react with the substrate, are complementary to the shape of the substrate. So you can see that if the substrate is shaped like this, then the active site is also shaped in a similar manner so that they can fit like a lock and a key or like a jigsaw puzzle. So when the substrate fits or binds at the active site of an enzyme, then the resultant product is known as the enzyme substrate complex, where the enzyme's shape changes very slightly as the substrate binds with it. And then the enzyme acts upon the substrate and it forms two products. And when these products are released, the substrate changed chemically. The substrate is now changed into products, into two different products, but the enzyme has remained chemically unchanged and it can be reused for another substrate. So this is how they work, and this is basically the lock and key hypothesis. Now I told you that we would discuss metabolism further. So metabolism is occurring in every cell. It's the sum of chemical reactions within every cell. Thousands of different chemical reactions are taking place in a cell, which are collectively termed as metabolic reactions or metabolism. And they are catalyzed by a class of proteins that are termed enzymes, as we discussed. There are two different types of reactions, two different types of metabolic reactions: anabolic reactions and catabolic reactions, or anabolism and catabolism. So in metabolism, you have both anabolic reactions and catabolic reactions. In anabolic reactions, basically smaller molecules join together to form a larger molecule. And in catabolic reactions, a large molecule is broken down to form a small molecule. And this happens with the help of an enzyme. So an example of anabolic reactions is where a larger molecule is formed is protein synthesis, where amino acids join together to form polypeptide chains, and then these polypeptide chains together form a protein, and this protein could also be an enzyme, because we discussed that enzymes are protein in nature. And this reaction is reversible because it is catalyzed by an enzyme. And similarly, then these proteins can be digested to form polypeptide chains, and these polypeptide chains can be further broken down to amino acids. This is an example of catabolic reactions. Digestion is an example of catabolic reactions. For example, where protein is digested to amino acids, or amylase, the enzyme amylase digests starch to maltose, or hydrogen peroxide is catalyzed to oxygen. It is broken down into oxygen and water by the help of the enzyme catalase. Now let's see, how can we classify enzymes? So enzymes could be intracellular or extracellular. This is pretty self-explanatory. Or they could be hydrolases and synthases. So what are hydrolases? Hydrolases are enzymes that act upon a hydrolytic reaction. What are hydrolytic reactions? They are catabolic reactions, which means there is a breakdown. They are catabolic reactions in which a water molecule is required to break any large molecule into small molecules. So an example of hydrolase is any digestive enzyme. For example, protease, specifically pepsin or renin, carbohydrates, lipase, and examples of synthesis are enzymes that perform protein synthesis or glycogen synthesis. They're actually forming large molecules. They're catalyzing the synthesis of any molecule. So let's have a look at the enzymes in our body. So in the buccal cavity, or in the mouth, you have starch you have amylase that digests starch into maltose. And in the stomach, you have protease enzyme, that is renin or pepsin over here. And then in the pancreatic juice, you have trypsin, amylase, and lipase. And in the intestinal juice, you have erypsin, maltase, and sucrase. You can see all of these enzymes written over here. And in the intestinal juice, you can also find lactase, lipase, and enterokinase. These all act upon different substrates, and you will learn them further in the digestive system. So what are the characteristics of an enzyme? They lower the activation energy, we discussed that, and hence they speed up chemical reactions. Now, we also discussed that enzymes are specific in nature. They have active sites that are complementary to the substrates, to the shape of the substrates, and they're required in minute amounts. For example, you need just a little bit of washing powder to wash a lot of clothes. and washing powder is an enzyme. Now, enzymes are sensitive to pH and temperature. That is the main difference between enzymes and catalysts. We'll discuss the graphs on how pH and temperature can affect enzyme activity. And then they catalyze reversible reactions, something we discussed earlier. So now, there are some limiting factors that can hold back the rate of reaction, even if you have an enzyme present. They affect or limit the rate of reactions. They can also increase the rate of reaction, or they could decrease the rate of reaction. For example, you have pH and temperature. When you're talking about enzyme-controlled reactions, pH, temperature, substrate concentration, and enzyme concentration are four limiting factors that you can take into consideration. So when you talk about pH, there is a specific pH for different enzymes that works best for them. Or for example, temperature. 37 to 45 degrees Celsius is the optimum temperature for enzymes. So this is the temperature at which enzymes work best. But temperature can also speed up a rate of reaction, but it can also decrease the rate of reaction. And we'll have a look at it in this graph. So see, the molecules are gaining kinetic energy, which is why first when the temperature was very low, what happened? When the temperature was very low, the enzyme was inactive or very little activity was taking place, right? And then this is the optimum temperature at which the enzyme is working best. And this is 40 degrees Celsius for most enzymes, or 37 degrees Celsius if it is an enzyme found in the human body, right? Now, then when you increase the temperature too much, for example, it's around 70 degrees Celsius, then the enzyme starts to denature. What does the term denature mean? Denaturing means that an enzyme starts to lose its active sites, or its 3D structure is destroyed. What does that mean? If you had an enzyme that had an active site sort of like this, due to very high temperatures, the active site could become something like this. And since the shape of the active site changes, the substrate can no longer fit into that active site and the enzymes can no longer work. So there comes a point at which the rate of reaction is completely zero. But when even when the temperatures are very low, there is no point at which the rate of reaction is zero at low temperatures, because at low temperatures, enzymes are very slightly active. The pH graph is a bit different because pH is related to ion concentration, but hydrogen ion concentration, but temperature graph was related to kinetic energy of the molecules. So in the pH graph, if you see, when you have a pH of around, let's say, 2, so it's not working, your enzyme. Let's have a look at the protease enzyme. Let's take an example of protease enzyme. So that has a different specific pH, but generally for enzymes, we're going to take the optimum pH as 7, which is neutral. So as the pH increases, the rate of reaction increases at a point where you reach the optimal pH, after which the rate of reaction starts to decrease because now the pH is too high or the substance is too alkaline for the enzyme to bear it. That's all for enzymes.